Hello everyone, welcome back to the workshop. So in this video, we are going to be forging some blanks that you can purchase from us over at our website, blacksmithingblanks.com. I'll leave that linked up down in the description down below if you are interested in doing so. But the blank that we're going to be focusing on today is the maple leaf bowl blank. Now we're going to be focusing on the type 1 blank. That's this one right here. And then in the later videos, we'll be focusing on a type number 2 blank of those. And I'll do a little something different in each video so you guys can see some of the different styles and some of the things that you can do with them, if you will. Okay, first step in this journey, we are going to put in the center vein. I'm gonna stay off the very tip because I don't want it to run all the way out to the tip. I personally just like it that way. And I'm going to work back towards the stem, trying to keep this fuller tool nice and even. Just like so. And that raises a nice little center vein. Put this back in the fire here, get this hot, and we'll have a little discussion about the tooling for this. All this is a spring fuller, or a spring swedge, if you will. I have a fuller on top and a swedge underneath. This can be done literally in a wooden block with a top tool like this. Take a simple bar, probably a quarter inch, quarter by one, bit of mild steel, grind a radius on one end, and use that as a fuller if you're working over a wood block. Hammer on one end and let the radius end do the work underneath. That's how simple this tool can be. It doesn't have to be elaborate. It doesn't have to be made out of high carbon tool steel. It doesn't have to be as elaborate as this tool is. If you are interested in making a tool like this, I do have an entire tool making series where I've made all of these tools as well on the channel. You'll find that linked up down in the description down below. But yeah, so basically if you don't have this tool, don't worry about it. There's a lot of ways of doing this project. You don't specifically need this tool. I'm just taking a shortcut with this tool to speed up video production, if you will. Now obviously if you have that tool, it'll be a lot handier in the long run, if you make up special tooling, if you're going to be doing this quite a bit, it might be worth it to go ahead and make up some special tools just for this job. I'm lightly trailing off there to the end. And there you have it. So there's our center vein. So now I'm gonna go ahead and come out from that center vein with additional veins branching off there. And I'm gonna use this same tool for that to create a raised vein look. All right, grabbing the leaf in slightly a different direction so I can keep everything in line. I'm gonna start out at the tip of this area. And I'm gonna work back into the body of the leaf. Pull that up. There you have that. Go to the other side now. Thank you. Okay, now that we've got our three main veins raised, or what I'm doing for this project, again, if you don't have any of this tooling, that's okay. You can use what you have at hand to make whatever type of vein styling that you'd like. Again, it might work well for you to go ahead and draw on it the veins that you're after, and make this project your own and unique. So now that we've got the veins raised on here, I need to iron out this thing nice and flat. It kind of cupped because of that tool and stretching of that material for that vein. So I need to get it flat again, because then I'm going to add in some secondary veins using nothing but a cold chisel. I've got this locked in a pair of tongs just so I can get my hands a little further away from the heat. In order to flatten out the thing though, and also to sink it later, I'm going to be using a rawhide mallet. If you don't have a rawhide mallet, you need to get yourself a wooden mallet. Rawhide mallets and wooden mallets that can be found almost anywhere online. I'll drop a link in the description, an affiliate link down below where you can go check out or purchase, you know, some of these type rawhide mallets, if you will. Now this one was made special for me, but I'll put some comparable ones down in the description. Again, that's an affiliate link, so be aware. So I'm gonna pull this out here. Dump that out. I'm gonna lay it on the anvil, face up, or the side up that we put our veins in previously. And I'm just gonna iron this thing right down. Just flatten it right out here. I'll flip it over again, just help get all this stuff flat and in plane. It's really what I'm looking for. I'll brush it real good. So I got a nice clean surface to work with. All right. And now I'm ready to add in some secondary lines. Now, this, you could do this however you like. I do, however, suggest that when you put in some secondary lines, that you don't overbite or try to bite onto the tall if you have a rib already. Don't add extra lines in that direction. Keep it out away from there if you can. I also like using when I'm creating my lines, is to do them the width, the full width of the chisel. So make your chisel lines that full width versus adding, you know, making the mistake of adding, trying to do a half chisel mark. Half chisel marks don't branch very nicely, and you make a chance, you create the opportunity to double jump. So if you make each cut of the chisel the length of the chisel, it makes for a very clean aesthetic. All right, so I got that there. I think I'm gonna add one up over here just for good measure. Just because it would look good, I think. Add me one right there. Good. Now I'm gonna go down to the other side, do a very similar effect. Now, since this is a cold chisel, you can work on this pretty cold, and you can always come back and deepen the cuts if you need to. Now, since this has already been heated up once in the forge, this is a really simple thing to do. Hot, like the lines are already deep enough that I'm beating into here, and I'm hitting it with quite a bit of force. So it's working out pretty great. Make sure my impressions are deep enough. Add one going up there. That looks decent, okay. I'm gonna add one coming off of here. These lines don't have to be perfect. They don't have to all match up on each side. In fact, it looks a little bit more natural if they don't. I'll show you what we've got progressed to so far. Again, this just adding some chisel lines and some raised lines. It's really gonna sell the effect later when we actually dish this out. You can get too crazy with this, I should mention. You know, it's real easy to take this too far and then it just kind of looks tacky. So you know, use your chisel lines sparingly and effectively if you can. I'm gonna add a little line right here in front. There we go. And I think down in here needs a line or two. So I'm gonna come off the middle here with a line. And on the other side, staggered a bit with a line. And come off each one of those with a branching line of some sort. Yeah, I think that'll look pretty good. Sometimes when doing stuff like this, less is more in the project. Okie doke, got my rawhide mallet sitting there. At my swedge block. Got the piece nice and heated up. And then we're gonna start working this down. Right into the base of the swedge block. Don't spend a ton of time hammering on the ridges themselves. Get it down to shape if you can. And as few hits on the ridges as possible, because those ridges will flatten out. That's why we made them so deep to begin with, because those ridges will flatten out on us. So there we go. Got that dished to start with. And now you need to start making some design choices for yourself, like how you would like this thing to flow. I'm gonna bend the initial points out, and I might give them a little bit of a back curl, but I'm gonna go ahead and bend them out right about where the lobes is. Again, this is all optional. This type stuff right here, this is what you do to make it your own, right? This is where it's your own piece of art when you get done. And it's no longer just a blank, you know, sitting there, just a square piece sitting on the square flat plate laying on the anvil, okay? This is all completely up to you to decide how you want this to look and how you want people to perceive it. So there we go. We got that much of it done. I'm gonna heat this back up and I'm gonna do some more curving around, but we'll be over at the anvil to finish this thing up. So now I'm gonna bend out the little stem on the back. We'll bend it out, and then I'm going to forge it down. You don't have to forge this. You do whatever you like with your own. You can spread it out, turn it into a spoon and ladle rest for the kitchen. You can round this up. You can leave it alone. Totally up to you. Your choice. I just like to forge them out a little bit. I think they look a little bit more natural when you do it that way. Or can look a little bit more natural anyhow. Oh, and I don't like them to end up perfectly even or in line with the rest of the piece. So now once I got that forged out, now I can work on my tips. I'm gonna put a little reverse curl on this one. I'm gonna continue it on around the horn. So we got a bit of a snakey do there. Again, this part is all completely up to you. This I'm actually gonna work down on the horn a little bit to thin it out, give it a little extra dimension. I'll probably grip this and give it a little bit more curvature as well. And then curve it back on itself. There we go. So as you see, I'm doing a good bit of work cold there. I'll probably heat this up again. And then we'll need to definitely get all the forge scale off of it that we can. Okay, now that I got all that done, now the only thing left for me to do is to go ahead and mark this with my touch mark. So I'm just gonna find a spot that's convenient for me, and I'm gonna put in my touch mark. Now I might have to go over the horn here for this. A lot of times I'll have to do this just to get in at the right angle. Of course I had to drop it, why not? But I got my touch mark in there. I'll mention this about touch marks real quick. If you're gonna put a touch mark on a piece of art that you plan on selling or a piece of forged work, there's only two ways to do it. And I do mean there's only two ways. This isn't one of those things where you've got 1,000 options and every way's the right way. There literally is only two ways to do it. And those ways are as follows. If you're going to add a touch mark to a piece, you either do it inconspicuously or conspicuously. So that means your touch mark either adds to the quality of the piece and it's an attractive place that it's been put at, that's the conspicuously portion, or it doesn't. And in which case, it needs to be added to the bottom, underside somewhere, hidden away in an inconspicuous location. So you either own it with the touch mark or you hide it in an area if you're going to touch mark your work at all. If you're not going to touch mark your work, none of that matters to you anyhow. But that's my thoughts and feelings about touch mark placement, if you will. So there you have it. There is the bowl. Again, comes a long way from a blank, from just a flat blank. I used to cut these things out by hand, and it would take me 2-3 hours to get in here and file all the edges smooth and get it all cleaned up and ready to go to this type of stage and turn it into a bowl, or a vessel for somebody. Now, I've sold a lot of these as spoon rests. So, you know, somewhere that somebody can lay a ladle down or something in the kitchen so, you know, the drippings off of it don't get all over the stove or the countertop. I've sold a lot of these like that, and I've sold them for about $1.75 each. So not $1.75, but $175 each. Now, again, your prices will vary, whatever you can sell them for if you have any aspirations in that. But there you go. So there's the final bit. The only thing left to do is to paint it and just do whatever type of finish work you'd like to do with it. So that's it for today. Thank you all so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. If you did and you want to support what we do, be sure to check out and maybe pick you up some of these blanks over at blacksmithingblanks.com. Greatly appreciate that. Another great way of supporting the channel is becoming a channel member, where you'll save big and get huge discounts on blanks by clicking that join button down below. And thank you to all of the channel members who are already part of the channel and the growing community here on YouTube. God bless each and every last one of you, and we'll catch you on the next one. Thanks for watching.